15 seconds. You ready?
Go! So, Bitcoin is a new kind of money. It's the first decentralized electronic currency, not created, not controlled by any single organization or government. It's an open source project used by somewhere between 5 and 10,000 people right now. So all over the world, there are people running the Bitcoin software, and they're trading about $30,000 worth of Bitcoins with each other every day, with no middlemen, no fees, no credit card companies. It's a startup currency, which has never happened before. A bunch of people, a bunch of websites have just started to accept Bitcoins. Bitcoin was invented by this guy named Satoshi. Well, at least he calls himself Satoshi. I'm pretty sure that's not his real name. He's this mysterious guy who was definitely inspired by the cypherpunks. Now, the cypherpunks were a group of hackers in the 90s who won the encryption wars. They're the reason why when you access your bank account or talk on Skype, you can have a private conversation that nobody can overhear. So the cypherpunks have done a lot of cool stuff. One of the things, they had the idea of creating an anonymous private money, but they didn't actually figure out how to do it until Satoshi figured it out about 3 years ago. Like any good hacker, he released he wrote the software and then released it to the world. Now, that is not Satoshi standing next to a Bitcoin. That is Stone Money on the island of Yap. And I'm showing it to you because Stone Money and Bitcoins actually have a few things in common. First of all, Stone Money was incredibly hard to make. There's no limestone on Yap. So the people on Yap sailed these canoes 250 miles to the island of Palau. They convinced the people on Palau not to kill them while they carved the money with tools made out of shell, and then they had to sail it all the way back. Bitcoin is kind of similar in that it's really hard to make. It's designed to be hard to make. Happily, your computer does all the work. You don't even have to get your feet wet. Another interesting thing about Stone Money is it's transparent. Everybody knew how much of it what there was, because it's right there outside. Bitcoin is similar in that every time a Bitcoin is created, it's transmitted across the network all over the world. Everybody knows exactly how much of it there is. So Stone Money actually had a couple advantages over the money we all use today. Decentralized, anybody can create it. The only really big minus was it was only good for big purchases, like, you know, the dowry for an important wedding. Bitcoins combine all the advantages of Stone Money with all the advantages of modern money. Really, the only downside is it's brand new. Nobody trusts it yet because it's so new. Only geeks really understand it so far. If you think about it, money's about trust. We have to trust that our central bankers won't just print money willy-nilly. Ben Bernanke doesn't have to get in a canoe and sail it anywhere to create $1 trillion. Satoshi didn't trust them. With the global financial crisis and bank bailouts all over the world, a lot of us are starting to wonder, can we really trust the people who control our money? Satoshi didn't, so he created Bitcoin. Now, I've been leading the Bitcoin project for the last month or so, but even I don't have the power to change the rules. If I tried, my version of Bitcoin wouldn't be compatible with anybody else's, and my Bitcoins would be worthless. It's a brand new baby currency worth about $3 million so far. I don't know where it's going to go, but there's a small possibility that in 50 years, it just might replace the dollar as the world's reserve currency. It might happen.
These geniuses have created this currency that is now starting to show signs of life. So on the program today, we have Gavin Andreessen and Amir Taqi. Gavin, you've been the technical lead for over a year on the project. Is that correct?
Yep. I've first heard about Bitcoin about a year ago and just started getting involved and have grown up to be, the de facto technical leader.
So Gavin, tell the audience, which is a mixture of entrepreneurs and technical people, in simple terms, what is Bitcoin?
Sure. Bitcoin is really two things. First thing that it is, it's the world's first person-to-person digital money. So it's a new kind of currency that is different from all the currencies that we've used before, like dollars or euros or PayPal, in that it's person-to-person. There's no central organization or government in control of it. So that's primarily what it is. The other thing that it is an open source software project that actually implements this currency. So, you know, we produce software that you can run on your computer to trade Bitcoins with people all over the world. The software creates a wallet that stores on your computer. And one of the really interesting things about Bitcoins is there's no account. I mean, you know, your Bitcoins are stored on your computer and they actually never leave your computer. You perform transactions against them and those transactions are sent across the network. But you are always in control of your Bitcoins. There's no, like I said, it's not centralized. So there's no central place that holds your money for you. They are right there on your computers.
So on a technical basis, I have the coins on my computer. There's no other record of them or transaction. If I throw this computer in the ocean, those Bitcoins go with it.
Yep.
Of course, like any other digital currency that occurs, people have to wonder, well, where did the initial dollars come from? How many Bitcoins are out there? And do those Bitcoins have any, in the way silver certificates were backed, you know, originally dollars were backed by silver? What is the origin of the coins?
Well, that's interesting. Bitcoins are really a pure money in that they are designed to be merely a kind of tokens of exchange. So there is nothing backing Bitcoin besides the fact that they're, by design, they're designed to be rare. So right now there are about 6 million Bitcoins in existence. Those have been created by, well, people like you and me running the Bitcoin software, generating them over the last couple of years. And the only reason that they have value is because people have looked at Bitcoin and looked at the algorithms and figured out, yeah, the algorithms are solid and the number of Bitcoins that will ever be in existence is limited. So, you know, you can think of them, you know, think of the analogy as being like gold and that there's only a certain amount of, you know, gold atoms in the world. And, you know, its rarity makes it a commodity that's useful to exchange and useful to hold on to store value.
Talk about Satoshi Nakamoto. Who is this?
Wow, this guy is really a mystery. He comes about 2 years ago, and he releases this source code just into the wild.
Satoshi is very protective of his privacy. I think he just doesn't like the limelight, and he has really stepped back from the project, and he's not involved in the day-to-day coding anymore. And he never had the right personality to kind of be the technical lead and, you know, be patient with people and, you know, do all of the other things you need to do if you're going to lead an open source project.
I really think he did it for two reasons, though. The first one is that he saw that the community's taking it up and, like, I have to let them take over now. Otherwise, if I dominate this project, then it's not going to be able to expand, which is a really noble thing to do. The second thing that he did, the reason he did it, is if you look in the past history, any other projects like this, you look at Philip Zimmerman in the 90s with PGP encryption, which is now used by banks and it's standard everywhere. You look at BitTorrent, which is made by Bram Cohen, and you see and also now with WikiLeaks, you see that the creators always of these new technologies have always suffered a lot of trouble and mayhem. And so probably he has like his own life and he doesn't want to like be subject to, you know, court orders and hassle, which I think is a really good way to manage the project, to become distributed, you know, diffuse the power structures.
Tyler?
If you had a currency like Bitcoin in use, then you wouldn't be able to have governments like the Serbian government engaging in currency manipulation in order to fund their wars of genocide or what's happening in Zimbabwe now. So this is the positive aspect of Bitcoin.
So in a way, it's taking power away from governments to manipulate currencies. It's protecting consumers by giving them anonymity where they might need it, to things like inflation or printing up more of the currency. The United States decided, hey, we're in a rut, we're going to print a bunch of currency. China decides, hey, we've got a trade imbalance, we're going to regulate the renminbi. All of these are manipulations of currency that uneducated consumers, uneducated currency holders are on the short end of the stick. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. I mean, one of the key reasons Satoshi built this system is exactly that reason, is to create a predictable, completely and utterly predictable supply of currency. So everybody knows how many Bitcoins there are. Every Bitcoin created is publicly announced to the entire network. And there's this algorithm that creates them at a entirely predictable rate. So, you know, we have this currency where the supply is predictable.
If you look at Bitcoins, they're so divisible. They're divisible to 8 decimal places. And you look at all of the content on the internet, and it's so easy to produce content. And a lot of this content isn't worth that much. Mm-hmm. But because the
You see it as a microcurrency.
That is one of the uses of Bitcoins.
So instead of paying a penny per article, I could pay 1/100th of a penny per article.
Right.
Well, I could put a full Bitcoin down at the New York Times, but that and have 1/1000th cut off for every page I read. What is the government going to do? I mean, who are we on the radar of any governments yet? Has the FBI called you guys, the CIA? Have your phones been tapped?
Yeah, actually, I'll be giving a presentation talking about Bitcoin at the CIA, at CIA headquarters in Langley, Virginia, in the middle of June. So Bitcoin has definitely popped up to the intelligence community's radar, and I'm going to be very interested to find out kind of what their concerns are, and you know, try to find out a little bit from them of, you know, what do they think of Bitcoin? I mean, it's
they invited you. You contacted them. How did that occur?
CIA. They contacted me.
Really?
So
how does that occur? You get a phone call and it's like, hi, this is Jason from the CIA. Would you mind coming down here and telling us about your open source project?
Actually, kind of, yeah. They actually have a, they have basically what's a venture capital firm that's owned by the CIA that invests in startups that they think might be useful to this or interesting to the CIA. So
yep,
this
I know
person
yep.
from
InQtel.
Yep. InQtel, that's them.
So InQtel was the intermediary.
Yep, they're the intermediary, and they I believe they have something to do with organizing. They have an emerging technology conference they put on for the intelligence community. And this year, they're talking about money. So they're very interested in Bitcoin. And I'll
When is that?
That's the middle of June.
Hey, Kieran, make a note. I want to go to this conference. I know the guys at InQtel as well. So get my InQtel contact on the line. And let's have him on the program. And let's go to this conference, because this sounds fascinating to me.
The legality question is really interesting. And I mean, there are legal scholars looking at Bitcoin and trying to figure out what is it. It doesn't actually fit the legal definition of a currency, right?
They never ever shut down BitTorrent. They tried very hard and they didn't succeed.
Right.
The second thing is, the USA is not the world, man. Like, the US government, okay, they can do whatever they want, but I live in Europe and we have Asia and Africa.
They've never blocked a packet globally.
Right.
So it's not like they could, and even if they did block, let's say the United States goes insane and you get some crazy, you know, right winger maniacal idiot in charge. Oh wait, we had that.
But if it wasn't,
and if we had that and they said, I'm going to block Bitcoin, I'm going to try to block Bitcoins, I mean, it's not going to work, because you could just get a VNC or whatever. You know,
VPN.
You can VPN out to another country. I could look like I'm from the Netherlands if I want. And you can't block you can't block a type of traffic.
That's what I was.
Because I'll send it over HTTPS or something.
Right.
Right? Am I right, guys? And tell me if I'm technically wrong here, but it's impossible.
No, you're
all you can do is just
right.
Look at history and just look what they tried to do with BitTorrent. In the beginning, they tried to flood the traffic. What does BitTorrent do? Encrypt it and just use dynamic ports. You know, the thing with BitTorrent is it's a huge amount of traffic. A video is a huge file to send over the internet. The thing with Bitcoin traffic is very small. And the internet is like a sponge. And the cracks are so small, and the packets from Bitcoin are just so tiny that they can just easily pour through. I don't see any way that it can be filtered, really.
This is a fundamental technological shift that could occur on the internet.
It's a platform.
And in the real world, it's a platform play that's open source.
This is one
of the most interesting things I've seen in 20 years in the technology business. Bitcoin is one of those moments where I told everybody to stop everything and get me a Bitcoin episode within a week, because it's so inspiring. scary and big that my prediction is Bitcoin is going to change everything or be shut down. It's going to be binary.
All or nothing. Yeah.
It's just an all or nothing proposition. The same way, it is the same exact as BitTorrent. Mm-hmm. BitTorrent changed everything.
About $30,000 worth of Bitcoins with each other every day, with no middlemen, no fees, no credit card companies. It's a startup currency, which has never happened before. A bunch of websites just started to accept Bitcoins. Bitcoin was invented by this guy named Satoshi. Well, so the cypherpunks have done a lot of cool stuff. One of the things, they had the idea of creating an anonymous private money, but they didn't actually figure out how to do it until Satoshi figured it out about 3 years ago. Like any good hacker, he wrote at least he calls himself Satoshi. I'm pretty sure that's not his real name. He's this mysterious guy who was definitely inspired by the cypherpunks. Now, the cypherpunks were a group of hackers in the 90s who won the encryption wars. They're the reason why when you access your bank account or talk on Skype, you can have a private conversation that nobody can overhear. It's the first decentralized electronic currency, not controlled by any single organization or government. It's an open source project used by somewhere between 5 and 10,000 people right now. So all over the world, there are people running the Bitcoin software, and they're trading.
Seconds. You ready?
Go! So Bitcoin is a new kind of money.